We all dream of seeing the world, but the realities of living somewhere outside your place of birth can be daunting, to say the least. Welcome to the Expat Money Show, helping you make the most out of your overseas career through conversations with successful expats on investing, entrepreneurship, self-improvement, and continual education, all while sharpening your financial acumen. Now please welcome your host, with over 20 years of overseas experience, Mikkel Thorup.
Episode 1. Wow, what a journey to get to this point. Now the real fun can begin, guys. Now we can create something really special together. I will get to who I am later, but first I want to explain what you're going to get out of this show. In this show, you're going to hear from influencers, entrepreneurs, and investors who are not only making a difference in the world, but who are doing it while either traveling extensively or living outside their country of birth as an expat. You're going to learn tips, tricks, and recommendations that will help you to find more success in your finances and in your life, as well as see what is hot in the expat communities around the planet. So who am I? My name is Mikkel Thorup, and I have spent nearly 20 years in continual travel, visiting more than 75 countries, including Colombia, North Korea, and Iran. I have been an expat since 2002, living in Central America, the South Pacific, Asia, the Arctic, and the Middle East. Throughout this exploration, I have really kept my eye on different businesses and investments, putting my money where my mouth is and finding some very interesting and often very different opportunities. I want people to understand that just because you were born in one country doesn't mean you need to spend your entire life there. And it certainly doesn't mean that you need to invest and put your money back into that country. Actually, it can often be more advantageous to build your business abroad and save a lot of money. Okay, so who's this show for? This show is for you if you are currently traveling or living overseas, or if you've always dreamed of doing so. This show is for you if you want to learn and be inspired by others who are absolutely killing it in their business. And listen, at the end of the day, we all left our homes for a little bit of adventure and a better opportunity. This show is going to help you maximize this. Welcome to the Expat Money Show. It is only fitting that the first guest on our show is someone who inspired me to begin the process of sharing my message with the world. He's a brilliant individual with a massive heart who never stops giving back and helping others in the community. He runs an engaging newsletter through startups.ae and is my co-host of a private mastermind group in the Middle East and is a household name in the entrepreneur community of the UAE. Today, we are very privileged to have with us Huthayfa Nawafleh.
Well, first, thank you for this interview. I appreciate that. And in fact, when it comes to entrepreneurship and business, I get so passionate about this. This is something I love to do, which is creating things, you know. So back in 2014, I have started this business called Kids Day Events. And it's a business around inspiring kids' activities, kids' events in the UAE. Doesn't matter if it's a big event or a small event, like a birthday party or a shopping mall activation for kids. This is what we're doing. And we're doing that, as just said, to inspire kids' activities and bring more joy and happiness to them.
And you're originally from where, Huthayfa?
I'm originally from Jordan. I came here like six years ago, something like that, to the UAE. And you've mentioned something about my background, of what I've, like, let's say, studied, let's say, in the university or the college. I didn't go to business school, in fact. I've studied English literature and modern languages, which is French, Germany, and I remember we took some Russian courses as well in the university, but all gone, you know, languages, use it or lose it. So whatever you practice stays with you, and the same goes for life. So whatever you practice stays with you forever. And that's my, let's say, educational background, but I never used my certificate anyway. Nobody has asked me for a certificate, not even in the jobs. Also, that was interesting. So I spent like 4 years in the college, and now I'm getting jobs without you asking me for a certificate for the university degree. That's a true story, by the way. I got jobs as an employee, and no one asked me to show the certificate.
So in your opinion, higher education, post-secondary education, whatever you'd like to call it, do you think it's important for people, or what is your opinion?
Well, see, this matter, in fact, it comes to what people want to do in their lives. If you are going to college to learn about, let's say, a profession, like you want to be a dentist, a doctor, a lawyer, you know, this kind of professions. Yeah, this kind of knowledge, you won't find it anywhere. And I'm not going to go to a dentist who say, hey, I got a hobby or I got passion about playing with people's teeth and I can help you with that. No, I will choose someone who got a degree, who's certified and who's like trustworthy. But when it comes to, if you are going to the university just to make money, let me tell you something about this. That's not the right place to go to. You know, I went to the college, in fact, to learn how to make money. Okay, they said to me back there and back in my country, English, study English and other languages, you will find jobs and they will pay you big time money. This is what they said to me. So I went there and studied this major in particular because I wanted to make money. But guess what? I spent like 4 years in the college and they've never mentioned money to me.
So you moved to the UAE roughly around what, around 2010?
Yeah, 2000 and let's say 11, yeah, something like that.
2010, 2011. And you came over here actually for a job?
Yeah, I came here immediately for a job. Yeah, like I just got an offer and signed up the offer and I said, yep, let's do it.
And how long were you working there for?
As an employee, you mean? Mm-hmm. Well, in fact, I'm the kind of person that, you know, it's hard to get me working for something that I don't believe in. So if you look into my career, you don't see me like staying in the same company more than 7 months, 1 year. That's the maximum. But one of the companies that I have stayed, in fact, for 2 years is a company that worked with helping entrepreneurs starting a business, establishing a business. So I spent 2 years and I was the head of that company. It was a small business. Like I remember we were like, I have 7 colleagues and I was like blessed to be and honored, in fact, to be their director. They are friends to me, not employees. And because of this environment, which is helping entrepreneurs, like I got it, you know, there in that place, I believe that when I got starting doing this job, I said, all right, this is it. This is what I want to do. I want to help entrepreneurs doing this because I love this entrepreneurship spirit, you know, because I believe entrepreneurship is not just about having a business or building a business. I know business owners who are not entrepreneurs because entrepreneurship is a mindset more than it's a business. You know, it's a way of thinking, a way of life.
So can you elaborate on that a little bit for me, please?
Yeah, sure. You know, this is how I see entrepreneurship. Entrepreneurs who are people who can solve problems. Entrepreneurs, people who take the initiatives. Entrepreneurs who think of solutions. Entrepreneurs, they want to make life a better place or a better for everybody around them. And having a business or building a business around an idea you believe in happened to be the, let's say, the popular definition of entrepreneurship. But I have to disagree with that because I know business owners who do not have this kind of stuff in their blood, what they're doing. They are greedy. They don't want to help others. They think of themselves all the time. And this is not the way that how entrepreneurs think, you know?
So entrepreneurs are small business owners, but not all small business owners are entrepreneurs.
Exactly, yeah.
So what makes you believe that you are an entrepreneur?
You know, the story happened, you know, which is, in fact, let's say 2 years after starting Kids Day events. And I did a lot of mistakes, big time mistakes. And I learned a lot from this journey. And from being, say, a small business owner and entrepreneur, I understand the pain, you know. It's not just like I know the pain. I've been through the pain. I have been through the challenges. And I've decided to take these challenges, these lessons, this experience that I have gained from starting and building a business in the UAE in less than 3 years of my stay here. And then I decided to take that knowledge and share it with everybody. That we have. That's why I've started like another business, which is about coaching and training and showing entrepreneurs and people who got it in their blood on how to do it and how to make it happen, how to transform their ideas into the kind of business reality they have dreamed of.
Sounds very interesting. And what has the response been with this new coaching program? What has the response been from the people that you've offered?
Well,
it
to? In fact, it's amazing. You know, it's more than what I was expecting in the beginning when I started this. I see that people want someone to help. They are open to listen. They want to change. They want to learn. They want to try new things. They want to listen to people who did it, who made it, and they are ready to take actions. So the response is really amazing.
So what were your expectations when you first got into it?
You mean expectation when I got into the coaching?
Well, you said it's more than your expectations. So what did you have in mind when you first started on this journey?
Well, in fact, I had in mind that people would start saying, who are you to teach us how to do business? Because I don't have the MBA. Right, I don't have this. I don't have the permission from let's say an educational institution to certify that I can do this. And I said, I thought that I might face this challenge, but the thing that now people got it, people understand it now, and they know that they should take the advice from the one who made it, from the one who did it, and not just only from, like, it's funny when you go to the business school and you want to take an MBA class, the one who is going to teach you how to make business and do a business is an employee. So that's irony, you know?
So did you feel like in the past that you needed permission from other people to do the things that you wanted?
In fact, I didn't feel that I needed permission. I know that if I can do something, then I got to do it. And no one can tell me that you have the permission. I know that the permission is coming from me only. But my concern was the readiness or the openness of the audience, of other entrepreneurs, to take the advice from someone who doesn't have the traditional permission, which is the certificate, you would say.
And you found that the UAE is ready for this opportunity, or?
I believe yes, absolutely yes, because the UAE is, people here, they have open-minded. It's they are part of the big game, the global game. They are part of the advancement that's happening all over the world. And yeah, they're ready, absolutely.
Very interesting, very interesting. So can you tell me a little bit about the way that you feel like the market is going these days with entrepreneurship and business? Because I know you have very strong feelings about it, and I think some other people would really benefit from your knowledge.
Looking into the market conditions, let's say, and looking into the future, let's say, of entrepreneurship and business in general, there are three sides of the coin, okay? You have the edge, you have the right, you have the left. And this is a lesson I have learned from Robert Kiyosaki. So, if you are looking into entrepreneurship, there are two ways to do business or to be an entrepreneur. There is the traditional way, which is raise a lot of money, get some brilliant idea, hire the best and the smartest people in the world, and get them to work hard for you so you may make money. And there is the modern way of doing entrepreneurship. Is building something around an idea you have passion for and leverage the power of the technology that we have it in our hands today, get it done, get it in front of the right audience, test it, try it, and grow it, scale it, and take it to the second level. So I would say that if, like, for those who are sticking with the traditional way of doing business and being, let's say, being around with entrepreneurship, will face big time failure and difficulties. But for those who are adapting and changing and looking to the way from understanding how it's going on now and how easy it is to get yourself started, those will be rewarded.
Very interesting.
Yeah, and the edge, there was like three parts. The edge is to stand in between these two parts and look to each of them and decide. You know, we all have the second chance.
So where do you stand?
In fact, I have made my decision, of course, in fact, and I am in the modern part. I consider myself to be there, in fact, because this is what I do. You know, if you look to Kids Day events, for example, I have started applying that to this company. Back at the early beginnings, I used to have 7 employees, and I like working very hard, and we're still limited. Now I have only 2 employees, and we are making more than what we used to make with 7 employees, and it's just rewarding. Why? Because we're using smart tools, smart technology. We're leveraging the power of the internet, and it's just cheaper and better.
So tell me a little bit of the ways that you were able to reduce cost in Kids Day's event from changing from a traditional mindset to more of a modern entrepreneurial mindset?
Okay, well, good question. See, the first thing that I have considered to do is to get into the business automation, you know. I started thinking about the tasks, the things that I can automate inside my business instead of having, let's say, a human working on that. So I looked into the marketing and the sales. So the sales and marketing. So these are the most important parts in any business, sales and marketing. And I have completely automated the process of sales, and I have completely automated the process of marketing. We're looking also on the events, or let's say the project delivery itself, like instead of having, getting all the items under my own business, I would say purchasing all the expensive stuff to do the projects or to deliver the parties or the events, I simply just outsource it. And guess what? It's way cheaper. there are people who have already established, you know, this mentality, like some entrepreneurs, when they get into the business, they want to do everything themselves and they want to have it themselves first. I disagree with that. If someone has it, I can take it. I can rent it. So that makes sense. Instead of having it in my store, I do have a store like for the most regularly and frequently used items. I do have a store for that. But when it comes to like to big things, just some people have it and just outsource it to them. I mean, even they wear my t-shirts, the company t-shirt when they come to the installation and the installation in the projects. It just looks completely mine.
So do you ever worry about not making the margins with outsourcing the thing, or how do you feel about it?
No, not at all. You know, you build, you know, when you work with suppliers, you treat suppliers the same way you treat your customers, even way better. Because the supplier is your partner, you know, you build relationships. It's all about building. We are human by the end of the day, and we got to build good relationships with other people around us. So yeah, instead of paying them 30 days later, I pay them in advance, so they're happy. They give me all the priority instead of making their life like hard if they have done a mistake. I just point them to the mistake and tell them, guys, we need to just pay attention to this in the next time. We don't want this to happen, and they appreciate that. So, you know, like these kind of simple things you do, and they become loyal to you. They give you the advantage all the time, like the priority, and they just want to work with you.
Excellent. So you spoke a lot about automation. So with automating your business, how has that affected your life? How has that freed up time or anything like that?
Well, that in fact gave me the time to start another business. This is how powerful it is. Not only that, you know, it's just even increased the sales. Now, we sometimes reject, say, orders because we don't have capacity for them. Mm.
Interesting. So what have you done with that extra time that you have now?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. I have started the coaching.
So tell me more about the coaching program that you're doing.
The coaching programs, in fact, I have online courses that's also automated, so like people can sign up for these courses and go through the training that I'm giving, in fact, to show them how to achieve certain topic or subject, you know, different kind of training, different kind of courses with different kind of deliveries. Also, I have one-on-one coaching as well, which is like a high advanced level of coaching where I get to work with entrepreneurs on one-on-one through Skype and Skype calls, and also through in-person meetings. So since I'm in the country here, and I can meet people face to face also and work with them to take their business or their ideas to and make them happen. You know, if they have a business, how to grow it, how to scale it, how to automate it, and if they want to start, how to start, where to start, what do they need to start, how to put things together. That's all this kind of support, and so I mean, like, staying with them along the way until they achieve the goal that they came for me with.
So tell me a little bit about the type of people that you would work with. This is young, this is old, this is men, women, where are they from? I'm curious.
Well, in fact, this is an interesting point. You know, I work with students, college students I'm talking about here. I work with employees, they want to start a business. I work with business owners with different kind of businesses. Like, I have marketing agencies, I'm helping them and delivering the message. I have dentists working with them. I have also restaurant owners. I have, you know, it's really different kind of businesses that I'm supporting and helping in here. And their ages is really, it's very, you know, like I'm telling you, college students, 19 years old, and restaurant owners, like, it's 47 years old.
So that sounds to me that the demographic is not so much based on age or gender or where they grew up, but more on a mindset or a belief pattern maybe that they have. Is that right?
Absolutely.
Because I keep coming back to this thought of what you said earlier, the difference between small business owners and entrepreneurs. I think this is a really interesting thing. I find that a lot of people don't understand the difference between this. They think that if they own a business, they were an entrepreneur, but actually they might only work in their business.
Yeah.
What's your thoughts on this?
Well, another interesting point about the traditional way of doing business and the modern way of doing business is that modern entrepreneurship meant to have your business working for you. While the old way of entrepreneurship is that you own the job, you're working for your business. It doesn't matter if you are the decision maker here. You can be a decision maker as an employee as well. for a big company, that's possible, but you still work for your business. So the idea here is that, you know, people meant to exist on this life, to create things, to make things happen, and also to help each other and enjoy their life. It's never meant to be like a full-time working for a company that you don't believe what they believe, that a company you don't feel you belong to, or you're not even secured in that company. It's never been this way life to be. Never life meant to live the life the way like of contribution, and also to enjoy life. Okay, so it doesn't make sense if you are just all the time working for something that you don't feel part of, just for money, you know?
So it sounds to me that you feel like you have a bit of a higher purpose, a real drive.
Exactly.
Have you found that this drive, this purpose, has propelled you in times when maybe otherwise you would have just been stuck?
Well, I would request you to reframe the question, in fact. Propelled you, what do you mean by that? I mean,
this drive that you have, does it come in handy when times are tough?
You know, no, it's not easy. It's not easy to keep your energy, to keep your passion, to stay standing tough times. And what holds my hand, in fact, when such times arrive, is just remembering and reminding myself of the reward of like the goal where I'm going to. So when you think about that, you say, yeah, that makes sense. Yeah. What you're after isn't something simple. It's not something easy. It's worth it. And this is part of the journey. You should keep going. Yeah, this is part of the journey. If you're going this way, you should pass from this place. That's it.
So I'm curious, when you mentioned goals, what are some of the goals that you have in your life?
Well, let's say one of the most important goals to me is to become, say, the well-rewarded person, say, or to become the well-known person of supporting and empowering entrepreneurship in the Middle East. Like being the go-to person when it comes to growing, building, starting, and motivating businesses and entrepreneurs and small businesses. Like, because I believe the future is in the hand of entrepreneurs. Like we see these initiatives that's changing the way the life is. Look at Uber, for example. It's an entrepreneurial idea that they have changed the way that the transportation works all over the world. It's got the chance for college students, whom they have a car, to earn an extra income from just dropping off their friends or their neighbors or somewhere around them. So that's amazing. So yeah, entrepreneurship is going to lead the future, and I want to be part of supporting entrepreneurs. I want to be honored, in fact, and to be recognized in supporting them in the region.
Very interesting. It's a lot to think about. So I want to back it up a little bit. And where did you have this original idea from for entrepreneurship? Is this something you were born with? Is this in your DNA, or where did this come from?
I can't say it is in my DNA. But I can say that I have started my first business, let's say, or my first try as an entrepreneur when I was like, I remember 7 or 8 years old. I used to use my bike and tour in my neighborhood to fix computers for people, like to do the software for them. And not only that, I got a business card. I printed a business card for myself as well, saying Huthayfa and his partners. And my partners was like my brother and my brother, and he was one partner, as saying, and he wasn't doing anything, but I want somebody with me, you know. I told him, all right, I sold him the idea, let's fix computers, we know how to do the computers, because we got a new computer, and I got excited about it, and I want just to like take it apart and then fix it again and then format it, do the software, then reinstall the Windows, and then, you know, so I have learned everything about it in just a month. And then I wanted to start helping others fixing their computers.
So what did your father say when he saw a torn apart computer?
He liked the idea, you know. He liked the idea. He encouraged me, in fact.
So have your parents been quite supportive of you?
Yeah. In fact, they've been supportive to like any initiative I would take.
Because correct me if I'm wrong, but you come from quite a large family in Jordan. Why don't you tell me a little bit about that?
Okay, well, that's funny. You know, when it comes to how the family thing works in the Middle East in general, and especially in Jordan and the GCC, you get this tribe thing. So you have a big tribe, big family. So, like, when you think about my family, like, the number of people, like, we're living in north of Jordan, middle of Jordan, and in the east of Jordan as well. So, talking about 100,000 people in the, like, they belong to this family, and way more as well. So, yeah, I call most of them uncle. You know? So, yeah. And my own family, which is like my father, my mother, and my brothers. I have 5 sisters and 4 brothers. So total, the family is 12, including my parents. And it's interesting, in fact, to be part of a big family, you know.
So of the 10 children, where do you fit in on the mix? You're the eldest, the youngest, somewhere?
I'm the eldest.
You're the eldest. So you have 9 siblings who are younger than you.
Yep.
And do you feel that being the eldest child has shaped you in a way or helped push you in a way as an entrepreneur?
Of course. It did help me a lot. In fact, being the eldest, I was blessed, in fact. But it is a responsibility, you know. It's not... because, you know, the kind of the family structure that's there in the Middle East, especially in Jordan, the family is really connected. So it's not like you're 18 years old and you just forget about your family. No, you got to stay connected. You got to support your family. This is something part of our life. That's responsibility coming to me, but it is coming with big time empowerment. So yeah, it's empowering, and but again, in the same time, it's big responsibility to be the eldest in your family.
Sounds to me like you were able to use this type of responsibility, and when you moved overseas, it was almost like you were groomed for a position of management and helping others. Does that sound right to you?
Yes, I would say yes.
So I'm just trying to get a picture of young Huthayfa growing up in Jordan, riding his bicycle and fixing computers. Did you have other people in your life that you were modeling this after? How did you have these types of ideas? What drove you forwards, even at such a young age, to be an entrepreneur?
Well, no, I don't remember that I have seen someone doing that. It is, in fact, it started with, we got a friend of my father, like a guest in our house, and he saw me fixing our computer. He like, I wasn't fixing, I was just, you know, I do the stuff, I like that, just playing with the softwares and, you know, putting it around, changing the RAM, adding this kind of stuff back that these days. And he said, my computer isn't working, can you help me? I said, sure, why not? Pay me 5 dinars. And my father looked at me and said, what? Because, you know, it's the kind of giving the help, it's shame to ask for money for doing anything to help. So I said, yeah, he wants me to fix the computer. If he wants to take it to the computer shop, they will charge him 20 dinars. I will go to his house and fix the computer for him, and I will take 5 dinars. And he said, yeah, he's right. So yeah, that's how it started, in fact. I don't know, I got the courage to ask for these 5 dinars. And when I got paid after fixing the computer, I felt like that's awesome, that's amazing. Let me do that. So I took these 5 dinars and I printed the business cards and I printed some brochures as well, and asked the little kids in the neighborhood to take these brochures and send it to the people's houses, and they started calling me.
That's hilarious. I can just imagine you now. Now, my next question is a little bit difficult. I don't know. Do you believe that people who want to get into entrepreneurship, do you believe that they need to have a background like yours starting at 7 years old or 8 years old?
No. In fact, that's one of the challenges that some people face while they have an idea and they want to act on this idea, but they think that because they don't have that kind of skills or that kind of special education or that MBA or that amount of money, or sometimes they doubt their idea itself, like, does it work? It stops them from taking actions on that. I would say no, it has nothing to do with your background if you're ready to take actions. Because entrepreneurship, again, it's a mindset. So if you have the mindset, let me just reframe, what is this mindset about? This mindset is about taking the initiative. It's about recognizing the opportunity when you see it. It's about taking actions. It's about taking risk. It's about standing responsible for your action. It's about bringing solutions. It's about helping others. So if you have this mindset, you can act right away, and you are an entrepreneur by default. You have it in your blood.
So where do people get this mindset from? Are they born with it?
Not necessarily. You know, they gain it with practice. They gain it with experience. They gain it with from investing in themselves to learn new stuff, like webinars, reading books. That's important source as well. You know, they gain it from their choices, their daily choices. You know, they gain this mindset.
Interesting. And when you said books, of course, everyone who's listening to this knows that I'm a voracious reader. I would love to hear your opinion. Is there a book that you believe that every human being should read?
The Expert Secret. I believe, yes, every entrepreneur should read, because the entrepreneur is an expert in a way or another in something. So this book is important, in fact. And for every person to read, for any, let's say, it doesn't matter if you're an entrepreneur or not, is the Stephen Covey book, which is the 7 Habits of the Highly Effective People. This is a very important book, in fact, I recommend everyone to read it.
Excellent. I'll put in the show notes for today's episode, links to those two books. I've read both of them, and I can definitely vouch for what Huthayfa is saying here. Two incredible authors, incredible pieces of work, and well thought out. And I would definitely agree with entrepreneurs being... having to read Expert Secrets, it really is very powerful. And Stephen Covey is one of my favorites, 7 Habits. It's just a phenomenal book, phenomenal book. Is there anyone that you look up to as a mentor? Anyone that you follow what they do?
Yes, of course. I can name a lot of names, in fact.
Who's been one of the most influential people?
Brendon Burchard, in fact, it has a big impact on building my life, in fact, and helping me building what I have today. So Brendon Burchard, his mentorship is not about business, you know, yet he got some courses and books about business, but Brendon Burchard helps you create that mindset, that mentality, helps you develop the strategy, you know, because I believe that everything in life is divided into two parts, which is the tactics, the things, the tools, you know, that you do. And then the other thing is the mindset. So these two things are the only two things that are responsible for your success. 15% of your success goes as a result to the tactics. 85% goes as a result to the mindset. So that's important part.
So when you dedicate yourself to learning, do you use those same types of formulas? Do you dedicate 15% to the tactics and 85% reading about the mentality?
Yeah, absolutely. I don't get to love with the tactic, with the tool, with the system, more than getting and believing in the mindset behind it. Let me give you an example in here. Look at what Russell Brunson is doing now. Like, he has the most powerful now software for creating sales funnels and marketing funnels in the world. But imagine having this funnel, this tool, this powerful tool, okay, without having the right mindset on how to build the funnel inside, how customers are thinking, how to take them through the flow of your funnel to sell your product. That won't help you. Nothing on earth would help you if you have the wrong mindset. Imagine a gun with the hand of a retarded man. That's hilarious. That he will start shooting everybody. That's crazy. It's like the same thing.
That is quite a visual, Huthayfa. Quite a visual. So going back to education, I would even call this modern education, to kind of coin your term of modern entrepreneurship, modern education. So you take a lot of courses. You do these courses in person. You do them online. You do them. How have you found is the most effective way for learning for you?
Well, I won't say it's the most effective way, you know, but I will say the most convenient way is doing them online. And also, when I get the chance to meet the coach or to meet the mentor in a workshop or something, I won't spare that chance. I will just immediately take it. I'll never second guess about it, because meeting them in person is priceless.
I agree with you there. I have big plans for next year. I'm going to base all of my holidays to fly to the United States, actually, to meet some of the people that I really look up to. I've never followed baseball or hockey or basketball or anything like that. Actually, I look to some really successful entrepreneurs. Those are my heroes. And I'm really excited for next year, meeting some of these people face to face.
Such people change the world, man.
Absolutely. Look at someone like Elon Musk. Like, what an animal. That guy is an entrepreneur on steroids. He's just the amount of dedication and tenacity and hard work that he puts in. It's just mind-boggling what he's done. Speaking about books, if people are interested, you really need to read his autobiography. What a human being. I think that everybody could really learn something from him. And I would really encourage you to read his autobiography. There's a lot of really fantastic information on there on how he got started and actually similar. Now that I think about it, similar beginnings from you and him. He was also working at a very young age with computer programs and writing more on the software side opposed to the hardware side, but similarities.
Don't get me in this spot. No. I won't compare myself to Elon, but I believe that every human got a talent in something, and every person got his chance in a way or another to show that talent. I would say that... Yeah, it's possible to leave an impact in this life in your way. So it doesn't matter if it is in technology, it's in teaching, if it is in inventing something new, if it's like, it doesn't matter. Everybody got a talent and got a chance to leave an impact.
So what do you think the best way is to harness that? How do you bring that talent to the forefront and then monetize it?
Well, first thing, you need to take actions, you know, a lot of actions. And how you take actions is, you know, by understanding that actions are engaged with risk. Any action is engaged with risk. So you, by taking actions, you also need to be willing to take that risk and stand responsible for the results that might happen. And also, if the result wasn't pleasing, that shouldn't prevent you from taking another action after that. So take action, make mistakes, adjust and change, and then take actions and make mistakes again. And this is how you harness this.
So you speak about making mistakes. What's your feeling about making mistakes or having failures in your life?
Well, again, I believe this is part of growing, you know, part of success. Because if you don't want to do mistakes, the only way to do that is to do nothing. And doing nothing is a mistake. So that's it. There is going to be a mistake, whether you like it or not. So yeah, it's just part of life to do mistakes. This is what a human does.
So if you make a mistake or if you fail at something, what's your immediate response?
I immediately look into what I have learned from that mistake. Why did I do that mistake, or how did it happen, and then take these lessons, and then from these lessons I craft, let's say, the next action, which should be redoing or doing the things or correcting the mistake if it's possible.
Do you find that you make the same mistake often, or are you pretty good about adapting quickly?
Well, now I'll say that I'm good about adapting right now, but I wasn't always that the same way. So let's say, you know, practice makes improvement. I would say that. They say practice makes perfect. I would disagree with this. There is nothing perfect in this life. There's nothing perfect. Absolutely, there's nothing perfect. Practice makes improvement. And the more practice you do, the more improvement.
So what type of advice would you give to someone who is wanting to start out on their entrepreneurial journey, but maybe they don't know which direction that they should be going in?
Okay. Well, this is an interesting question, and it's frequently asked question, in fact, when it comes to starting and what advice you have for people who are starting out. I would say that it's a common sense. My answer is a common sense, but the question after this answer is it a common practice? Because, you know, if it's not a common practice, then you got something to do here. The answer is that you do something that you have passion for. Again, I will rephrase what Steve Jobs said about this, when he said, because if you don't have passion about what you are doing, any rational guy would quit. And that's true. Because if you are doing what you're doing out of the passion, you will see it in a different way. But if you're doing it just for money, or just because you think this would be nice to be done, or you're doing it because you know how to do it. I know people who are starting a business because only because they know how to do it. It's not just out of passion.
you will find challenges. You will face big time challenges down the way. And the only thing that will keep you going is your passion. Because there will be moments that you, like everything around you, is just telling you what you're doing is wrong and you gotta quit. The only thing that will help you continue your march is your passion. So yeah, start something out of your passion and take actions. Take actions as much as possible. Stay focused on that thing. Keep hitting. Keep taking actions.
So you said focus. That's one of my favorite topics as well. Elaborate a little bit for me on focus, on your thoughts on focus.
Okay. You know, entrepreneurs have great energy, in fact, when it comes to implementing their ideas. They have great ideas, good ideas all the time. It's never running out of ideas. And they want to take actions and they want to do all these ideas at the same time. They are working in too many different projects, too many different ideas. And they think it's possible to have them all working for them. Well, the question here, the idea here is not that it's possible or if it's not possible. The idea here is that to focus on just one single project or one single initiative and get better at that point. So imagine if you have all this energy, all this talent, all this, let's say, skills that you have or you are building, just directed to one single direction or one single idea. How powerful, how amazing it is going to happen and how fast it is going to happen. Because, you know, this will help you see results faster. Seeing results is important to keep your motivation up. If you're working on something and you're not seeing results, your energy will drain out and you will start like second guessing around it. I mean, does it work or what's happening? And you wonder why you don't see results. You didn't see results because you are too distracted. You know, you're dividing yourself too thin and too working on too many different projects, too many different ideas. That yeah, it seems impossible to see results fast. And I believe we are living in a very fast world now. We want to see results faster. Yeah, I don't want to wait 3 years to have a successful business. I can have it in 1 year. Or less.
So what are some of the ways that you will stay motivated then?
First, surround yourself by the right people. Okay? This is the first thing. Get rid of the negative people. I'm not going to say that just screw your relation with them, but replace them with positive people. Find positive people. You may ask, where do I find them? A lot of options, you know. You can hang out, go to the seminars, go to attend webinars, go install Meetup as an application in your mobile phone and start attending meetups. Search for them, find them, build a relationship with them, and that's the first thing you need to do in if you want to keep your energy and you want to stay motivated. And second thing is read and, let's say, YouTube some success stories that, you know, see what they're doing and what they how they have done that, you know. This stuff works.
And this has worked for you in the past?
It did.
And now these are things that you put into action, or this was in the past?
No, I'm still sticking to this. I watch motivational videos. I hang around with positive. In fact, I'm proud to say that I don't have negative friends now.
So is that something that you systematically went through and changed in your life, or that's just something that happened?
No, I systematically went through and changed it.
And would you recommend other people to do that?
Absolutely.
Yeah, I would as well. I think that if you go through your news feed on Facebook and you see people that are complaining, you know, unfriend them. If you
don't want to like to hurt their feelings by unfriending them, just unfollow them. Like, for example, for me, if you scroll in my news feed to let's say a year ago, you'll never find even a news that's I don't follow news, by the way. Nothing. Because
are you ever worried that you don't know what's going on in the world?
I'm not worried, no. I'm confident that what is ever going on, I'm ready to face it.
You do know that Donald Trump is the president
not till this way, you know. This is entrepreneurship. I'm learning from Donald Trump how to do entrepreneurship, you know?
Are you now?
Yeah, I am. Big stuff, big stories to learn from Donald Trump. Away from politics, I'm not into politics. But I believe, like, look into the word news. N-E-W-S. North, East, West, South. It's just destruction. So I don't follow news. I learn about the important stuff from people, from the world that I care about, which is entrepreneurship. I learn about this stuff from them. But I don't want to see what's happening in every place on this, in this planet. It's not my job.
So I guess this ties back into focus.
Yeah.
You've removed things that are not going to keep you in the right mindset.
Exactly, exactly. You know, even YouTube started to figure this out, and they don't suggest such thing for me as well.
Wow.
Yeah, because their algorithm now understand my algorithm, and we're working very fine with that together.
So I would like to just talk for a minute on, because this is the Expat Money Show, the training and the courses and the programs that you personally take that have helped propel you forwards. Give the listeners a bit of an understanding of the type of money that you would spend on these types of courses, say, throughout a year.
Let me give you an idea. I'm not going to say I mention numbers, but I will say that in just the first 3 months of this year, I have spent on training and investing myself, like, in knowledge, more than what I have invested on my 4 years college education.
Okay, that should give people a very good, they should be able to imagine how that the type of numbers that we're talking about. And a lot of people, they'll always talk about ROI, your return on investment. Have you felt like this ROI has been, quote unquote, worth it?
Yeah, of course, absolutely. Man, 1 hour of giving consultation for a local business here in Abu Dhabi is paying me $1,000.
Yeah, so you charge about $1,000 an hour, I mean, for your time.
This is just like a friend. I charge more, in fact, because I know the value. But this is a friend, and I give this preferred price to them. So this is just like the minimum. I'm talking about the minimum, you know. So, yeah, of course it does. And, you know, an interesting point, you know, when I get invested in myself in learning stuff, I also can help other entrepreneurs as well and help my clients. For example, let me give you something. You know, I have a student in one of my coaching programs, and she studies in Stanford University. Okay? She's in here in Abu Dhabi. Like, I don't know, it's vacation or something. I don't know. I don't know the calendar year there. In one of the one-on-one, or let's say face-to-face coaching that I gave to her, after I'm done with the coaching, we're done and we're about to go, she said to me something that shocked me. She said, "This 2 hours that we have spent together is worth my tuition for Stanford."
Very powerful.
That's how powerful it is. You know, we get to the point immediately. Like, cut the crap. Let's talk about the real stuff. Things that I can take action after I listen to. Okay, I went for 4 years to college, and after graduation, the only action that I was programmed to take is to find a job. And they didn't even tell me how to find a job. I have to figure this out, you know? But when you go to such coaching, such programs, you leave with a concrete action plan. That's the power we're talking about here. Yep,
I agree with you 100% there. I agree with you. I believe what you believe, Huthayfa.
Thank you, buddy.
To use your words. Thank you. So thank you very much for your time, Huthayfa. I really appreciate it. And I know my listeners do as well. If people want to get a hold of you, where is the best place to do that?
Well, let's say you can visit me, visit my website, startups.ae, and I will find my way to you. Just visit the website and I will find you. Don't tell me how, that's my secret.
Yeah, Huthayfa will work his magic. Excellent. So I will put the link to that in the show notes for today's episode. And once again, Huthayfa, I really thank you and appreciate your time here today.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you.
Thanks, guys. We'll see you in the next episode. And always remember, endeavor to greatness.
This episode may be over, but your journey to greatness continues by visiting our webpage and signing up for our newsletter. For convenient access to new episodes, show notes, and other crucial resources, visit expatmoneyshow.com. We look forward to you joining us on the next episode of the Expat Money Show. Safe travels.